Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to St. Edward for our celebration of the third Sunday in Ordinary Time. Before we begin, we ask that you please silence your cell phones. Thank you. Our presider today is Father Rick. Please join us in singing our gathering song, Alleluia, Give the Glory, number 319. 319. Please stand.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, as we gather this morning, we first take a moment to pause and reflect on those times that we've sinned, so that we might prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. Lord Jesus, you were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
We adore you, we glory. take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world. Receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father.
Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, direct our actions according to your good pleasure, that in the name of your beloved Son, we may abound in good works. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. First the Lord degraded the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the end he has glorified the seaward road, the land west of the Jordan, the district of the Gentiles. Anguish has taken wing, dispelled is darkness, for there is no gloom, but now there is distress. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Upon those who dwelt in the land of gloom, a light has shone. You have brought them abundant joy and great rejoicing. As they rejoice before you as at the harvest, as people make merry when dividing spoils. For the yoke that burdened them, the pull on their shoulder, and the rod of their taskmaster, you have smashed as on the day of Midian. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord is my light and my reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. I urge you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree in what you say, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and in the same purpose. For it has been reported to me about you, my brothers and sisters, by Chloe's people, that there are rivalries among you. I mean that each of you is saying, I belong to Paul, or I belong to Apollos, or I belong to Cephas, or I belong to Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, and not with the wisdom of human eloquence, so that the cross of Christ might not be emptied of its meaning. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and went to live in Capernaum by the sea, in the region of Zebulun and Naphtali, that what had been said through Isaiah the prophet might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun and land of Naphtali, the way to the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who sit in darkness have seen a great light. On those dwelling in a land overshadowed by death, light has arisen. From that time on, Jesus began to preach and say, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." As he was walking by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew, casting a net into the sea. They were fishermen. He said to them, "Come after me, and I will make you fishers of men." At once they left their nets and followed him. He walked along from there and saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets. He called them, and immediately they left their boat and their father and followed him. He went around all of Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom, and curing every disease and illness among the people. The gospel of the Lord. Good morning. You know, as we reflect on our Lord's ministry and his mission, which was accomplished primarily over a three-year period, we look and see that there were times in that mission, that ministry, that Jesus had to make critical decisions. Not everything was perfectly laid out in front of him for those 3 years. There were times when certain things would arise at certain times, and he would have to make very important, very critical choices. And one of those times took place in our gospel today. and it's mentioned at the very beginning, so it may have slipped past our ears right from the start, but it was the mention of the arrest of John the Baptist, the arrest of John. That was for Jesus a sign. Remember, John was the last of the prophets. He was the one who would proclaim, who would herald the coming of the Lord, who would call the people to repentance, to make straight the path of the Lord into their hearts. He had been silenced. So Jesus knew with that that the moment had come for him to step to the forefront. His mission had truly begun. And it's clear from what we heard later in the gospel, he did not start that mission alone. And he wouldn't continue it alone either. He began the work of salvation, of our salvation, of the salvation of every human being that would live with the calling of disciples, with the help of disciples, his chosen apostles. Here today, 2,000 years later, our Lord continues to work in the same way. He calls and he invites regular people, mostly regular people. Of course, we know in the church there are some brilliant intellects and brilliant scholars and outstanding pastors and all the rest. But mostly he calls regular people, people like me and people like you. And he calls us to become his disciples, his apostles, and his missionaries throughout the world. Look at how Jesus extended that invitation to those he first called. We hear this in the gospel this morning. He went out to meet them in the middle of their work, which was fishing for those first who were called. He didn't wait for them to come to the synagogue. He didn't wait for them to come looking for him. He went out to meet them where they were. He entered their environment. He entered their everyday lives. He wanted to enter into their regular routine. Well, today he calls us the same way. He meets us in the midst of our lives and invites us to follow him, to follow his path, to follow in his footsteps. But this is the thing. He's not going to make it happen for us. We have to make it happen for ourselves. How? By listening to him, by learning from him, and when necessary, by leaving our nets, our negative relationships perhaps, our ill-conceived notions, our hang-ups and our biases, anything that hinders us from hearing and heeding clearly Jesus' call. We have to leave those things behind. Now reflect on this again. Jesus comes to us as God in flesh, as Emmanuel, God with us, God who is all-powerful, capable of doing anything and everything. Yet he chooses to involve humanity in the work of salvation. By doing this, he teaches us something important about ourselves. We, you and me, who are gathered here this morning, we have a vital role to play. What do I mean by that? We are not supposed to be disinterested, uncaring, or inactive bystanders when it comes to the eternal fate of others, of those around us. I know we can get frustrated at some point. I know I can at some point and say, look at all these people out here who aren't coming. Well, to heck with them. No. No. Not in the least bit. Not in the least bit. Jesus gives us the choice to say yes or no to being his co-workers in saving the world. Yes or no to participating in his mission, his ongoing mission, which will not really come to its culmination or to its end until he returns. He wants us to continue the mission he gave his church, which is all about the salvation of souls. Brothers and sisters, we can think about, we can talk about, we can plan all kinds of things, that the church is involved in our communities and in our world, our corporal works of mercy, our spiritual works of mercy, works of charity, all of these kinds of things. But we cannot ever forget what the primary mission of the church is all about. It's about saving souls. It's about bringing people to Jesus Christ. Jesus is continually calling us to work with him, to work alongside him, by drawing others closer to him through our examples, hopefully, of humility, of faith, and concern for our neighbor. We respond by listening to, maybe we don't always perceive them as clearly as we would hope or as clearly as we would want, but those little tiny whispers that we hear in our mind, in our conscience, those small inspirations the Holy Spirit sends us each day. Even and especially when they lead us out of our comfort zones for the sake of our neighbors. Jesus keeps calling us. He keeps calling us because he loves us, because he wants us to be with him, because he knows that only he can fill our lives with the meaning and purpose for which we long. And we know if we want that for ourselves, we should also want it for others. Jesus calls us not for his sake, not by any means at all. He calls us not for his sake, but for ours. He calls us for our sake. And when we respond, he stays with us, always at our side. We respond to him so that he can work through us and with us. He's calling us again today. He'll call us again tomorrow, and the next day, and the next day, and the next. When Jesus calls, we must respond. We must respond to that call. If necessary, like our disciples did in the gospel this morning, leaving behind the boat, whatever that boat might be in our life that we love, and the nets, whatever those nets might be in our life on which we depend, for something not easier, absolutely not easier, and for something not less challenging, but for something so much more important, for something so much more meaningful and so much more satisfying than we could ever possibly imagine. And that is helping to lead others to him for the sake of their salvation. Stand. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Heeding our Lord's call to follow him, so that we might walk in his footsteps and bring the kingdom to to those who need it, we lift up our prayers and petitions. That the church may proclaim effectively the good news of Christ to those who live in the darkness of oppression and division, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our national and local governments may always have the grace to rise above factions and place the common good as their top priority, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may heed the Lord's call to reform our lives by striving to eliminate injustice, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all those who teach may find wisdom in their work and joy in the call to shape the lives of those in their care. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who are sick or suffering may find in their weakness that they are close to the saving love of Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who have died may be led to the light of the resurrection. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the repose of the soul of Arlene Frazier, whom we remember in a special way at this liturgy, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Good and gracious God, hear the prayers we offer to you with humility and trust, and answer them according to your holy will. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our presentation hymn is You Are the Healing, number 525. 525.
To live, Jesus.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord
accept the sacrifice in your names for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Accept our offerings, O Lord, we pray, and in sanctifying them, grant that they may profit us for salvation. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by his birth he brought renewal to humanity's fallen state, and by his suffering canceled out our sins. By his rising from the dead, he has opened the way to eternal life. And by ascending to you, O Father, he has unlocked the gates of heaven. And so with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world. For by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Robert, our bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace. The Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Number 608, your words are spirit and life. 608.
Living.
Please remain seated. Bishop McClory has given the pastors of the parishes of the diocese permission, if they so choose, and I would like to do this, to resume distribution of the Eucharist under both species, which would mean also the precious blood and the chalice at Mass. What I'm trying to do is just informally kind of get an idea in regard to the expected participation from the chalice among our congregation. So our planning for the number of Eucharistic ministers, extraordinary ministers of Holy Communion we would need at Mass. Please don't be shy. There's no judgments being made here. If we would resume the chalice, if you would plan on partaking from the chalice, please raise your hand. I just want to get a general idea of what we're looking at. Hold them high. So, okay, it looks like maybe about a third, am I judging right? Maybe about a third, maybe a little less than a third. Okay, that's all I needed to know. And we'll move forward from there. It was about the same, maybe a little more last night, maybe a little bit between a third and a half. So kind of getting an idea of where we're at and understanding if you prefer not to receive from the chalice at this time, but so we can plan accordingly. Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that receiving the grace by which you bring us to new life, we may always glory in your gift. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Some announcements this morning. We are updating our list of ministers of care. These are people who bring the Eucharist to the homebound people who are not able to come to Mass. All ministers of care, if you are currently a minister of care, please call Deacon Bob so he knows about your ministry in case it got overlooked, so we can update our parish list. Also, if you are interested in being a minister of care, bringing communion to somebody who's not able to join us at Mass, please also call Deacon Bob and let him know you're interested. Also, liturgical ministers, we're working on a new schedule that will begin February 12th for all the ministries at Mass. Please check the preference sheets in the sacristy or reply to the email that was sent Saturday morning. Next weekend, two events taking place. It'll be the fifth Sunday, so the Knights of Columbus will be leading the rosary after each of the Masses. And also, altar and rosary will be having a bake sale. They're raising money so we can pay for the bill for the water main that broke, and they had to come out on Christmas Eve. You can imagine what the overtime and extra whatever was on that. That was a $5,500 bill. So we're going to sell some cookies to try to pay for that. Buy a lot of cookies next week. What else? I don't want to lose track of anything. Okay, tomorrow, normally it would be today unless it falls on Sunday, but tomorrow for the church in the United States, it's a day of prayer for the legal protection of unborn children. I've got a couple of things that relate to the two primary life issues. Please take, and if you want to take an extra copy to give to a friend, there's two booklets. One is called Why We're Pro-Life. It's a very short booklet, and the other one is from the Indiana Catholic Conference about the death penalty and the teachings of the church on both of these things. Sometimes we find we don't always agree with the teachings of the church, and one thing I found in my life, and I'm not just saying this because I'm a priest, usually when I try to put my opinion over the teachings of the church, not usually, but always, I'm wrong. I don't have a greater collective, a greater wisdom than the 2,000-year collective wisdom of the church. So it takes some humility to admit that. So please take one of each so you know the teachings on both of these critical life issues. And I think that's it. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks.
Thanks be to God.
Our closing hymn is Take the Word of God with You, number 382. 382.